be certain to subscribe to this channel, Deprogram Enlightener, and also my backup channel, The True Disciples of Christ, and also A Spokesman for Men. Subscribe to this ministry as we're in the last days. This is the voice of Kahan Tazadok, Deprogram Enlightener. Be certain to subscribe to Tazadok on Instagram and Facebook as well. Shalom. Most High in Christ bless.
Shalom, brothers and sisters. Once again, it's the voice of Brother Tazadok. Today's date, according to their calendar, is February 6, 2012. For the record, I'd like to reserve all of my rights according to the Bill of Rights and the Constitution of the Federal Republic. This is not legal advice. I did not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent attorney and please be advised. This is for informational, educational, and entertainment purposes only. With that being said, I wanted to talk to you today about third-party interference with contracts. And keep in mind, any kind of esquire, attorney, lawyer, so on and so forth, it's a third party. If they're not actually one of the people that actually constructed the contract. Now, in a contract, in contract law judgment settings, brothers and sisters, questions sounding in the tort of actually the unfairness regarding the interference of a person that's actually not a party to a contract is actually in causing a person who is a party to a contract not to honor his contract is pretty much irrelevant. Now, as I will explain later, if time permits, so when a person cries, I don't like to use that word person, when a soul cries of unfairness and wallow up at the judgment day as claims of unfairness will actually be heard in heaven had Satan's lower key assistants hacking away at us down here in this hell known as the United States, this corporation. Those cries will actually be in vain. Likewise, the unfairness in the contract outside, well, the unfairness of the contract law, should I say, outside interference in contract and the admiration is irrelevant when you are actually measuring a contract's performance within itself. Now, you're saying, damn, guys, what the hell are you, what are you talking about? Let me give you an example. The fact that an employer terminated your livelihood and you, as a result, subsequently experienced a sustention of money coming in, and now you are actually unable to pay your apartment lease. You're unable to pay the payments on your mortgage. It's irrelevant. In a tenant's actually eviction process, either you actually have paid your rent as the lease contracts calls for, or you haven't. They don't care about personal feelings or your actually livelihood or where you're going to live. They going to order you that contract. So even though the secondary effect of your livelihood actually being terminated from your employment, and I went over employee, when you look at Black's Dictionary, it's actually a conjunction of two words. M is for employ, deceit. So employment is for deceit. I talked about that in my earlier videos, but I mean, let me continue on here. So even though this may actually, the secondary effect of your livelihood of actually being terminated directly restrain you from honoring that other contract, your and, you know, honoring your lease contract due to the lack of this fiat currency that they refer to as money, your employer is actually not a party to the apartment lease contract. So what your employer did or did not do is not relevant in the leasehold eviction process. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? So this is contract law, brothers and sisters, jurisprudence. It's cold, it's mean, it's cruel, it's harsh, and it isn't very fair. But this is what the sewer, now, as the system, has set up. So now, addressing that, like head on, face on, we should actually start to negotiate our personal business contracts on terms we can actually live with, rather than, like, to snicker at these judges, allow fairness and so on and so forth, and complain about that. So we have to be careful of the contracts that we sign. In short, to make it very simplistic, we have to be careful of these contracts that we sign. Because when you go to the judge for the ruling, they're going to argue that contract. They're going to argue that contract. They're going to argue that contract. Contract, contract, contract. So the actual settings presented to the judge for a ruling will always work a tort on the other party. Now, what is the correct solution? Ignore all claims for fairness and just enforce the contract. Contract, contract, contract. Get out of your emotional state, because your emotions are going to get you trapped up. Your emotions is going to get you caught up. Cold, brutal, mean, harsh. Yes, but proper. I mean, that's the way you got to be with this sword. You're talking about emotions. Oh, I don't want to. And they don't give a damn about you. So you're going to have to be a little more harsh. Gird up your loins like a man. Be a little harsh, because that's how you have to deal with your foes, with your oppressors. But proper, rather than sit there and snicker at the judges at the late date, well after you are already in default of this contract. Now you might want to address the origin of your problem. You entered into a contract. You actually could not handle a worst case scenario. And worst case meaning loss of livelihood. So be careful of these contracts that you enter into, brothers and sisters. And those are the kinds of actually very narrow pieces, very narrow, precise lines that we need to think about in understanding contract law. You may very well have legitimate migrating circumstances that actually justify why you could not honor the contract. But is an election of remedies for the party that you are in default to decide what he or she intends to do with you. You need to consider all of this before you enter the contracts and talking about what can I do. And it is actually not anything for an enforcement judge to take notice of. But contrary to the sub rosa silence of this satanic system existence of any of contracts in effect with the Most High. So you're operating under contract law. You're operating under contract law, jurisprudence, with all of us down here in the sewer of the United States of America, under Satan's authority. USA is under Satan's authority. So, I mean, the rule has become wicked. You got the gun grabbers. You got those that want to deprive you of freedom of speech. This is a wicked system, brothers and sisters. I just call it how I say it. And this is all, what am I citing? Bible prophecy. It's all written that this will come to pass. We're supposed to be in these conditions. Some of you are like, why am I like this? What? Supposed to be this way, brothers and sisters. The closer that we get to the end, the more harsher this system, this satanic system, will come down upon us. It's supposed to be this way. But you gotta try and survive. The real judge is going to judge this corporation, this Babylon, this modern day Egypt, this Nineveh. The real judge, the Most High, is going to judge this. And he's sending the Mashiach to bring a judgment about. A government should be on his shoulders, meaning this current government is going to be finished, according to scripture. So tort law, the quality of judgment, fairness, requires that a person be a judge on the basis of how other similar people are being a judge. But this is not relevant to the judge. It is not relevant to our final judgment. It's only relevant to these contracts that man has constructed, and surely man is at loss. Man is at loss, brothers and sisters. So, these torts that are actually committed by us, and these great things that are done by us outside of our contracts, are irrelevant to these people that's judging. And they're definitely irrelevant to ourselves at Judgment Day, when we have stepped before the only judge, the real judge. It's irrelevant then. Now, will there be factors of natural tort law, such as fairness, rights, equality, and justice? So, brothers and sisters, the Illuminati. And some of you know what I'm talking about. The Illuminati, the Luciferians, the ones of light. The Masons, the Shiners, the Elks. And some of you, you follow this. They're going to go into judgment. They're going into judgment. Judgment Day. Right now, they're running this world. And they're operating under Satan's authority. And I'm going to tell all of you Masons something. That think that you're wise. You think you got some secret. The secret is you're studying yourself. You're studying yourselves. And those of you on a lower level don't know a damn thing. You're being controlled. You think you're worshiping God, but you're worshiping the God of the underworld, which is really Satan. That's what democracy is. Demokratis. Democracy is the rule, not of God, but the rule of the devil. So you're going to be judged. You're going to be judged. You're oppressing these people. You're oppressing us. You're going to be judged. By the one judge. You're going into the judgment day with the Heavenly Father. And all of your immoral behaviors is going to be judged. And tort law excuses all for instance, like the constitutional so-called going on into a 7203 prosecution judgment with a bank account, contract, and arguing principles of natural and moral tort law. Some of you may not understand what I'm talking about. Some of you may. Some of you may. And when I say that, I'm saying a want of men's morality, rights, basic judgment, privacy rights, no corpus delicti, damages, unfairness, excessive Eighth Amendment punishment for mere omission, common law, says, etc. and then actually demanding justice. And all of these elements of tort law pronounced very well through the numerous Supreme Court rulings and constitutional classes, but they are not applicable to the merits of a contract law judgment setting. So both the Presidio Clever Illuminati and the well-meaning constitutionalist who actually still needs intellectual development on contract law jurisprudence are both totally convinced that they are absolutely correct. Both of you think that you're correct. But the unknown reality that they're both just plain wrong. And for this reason, their arguments, their reasonings, and justifications, although absolutely correct in another judgment setting, appear in natural moral tort law are off point by wide variance, because in both of these judgments, in Judgment Day, the Illuminati and the well-meaning constitutionalists are being adjudged by the Most High. They're going to be judged by an invisible contract jurisprudence and contract law, not tort law. You're going to be judged by the law, statutes, and commandments of the Most High. Did you keep the law, statutes, and commandments of the Heavenly Father? And I'm going to have to continue this soon. Shalom. Shalom, brothers and sisters. Once again, it's Brother Tazadam coming at you through the Spirit of the Most High in Christ. This is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. This is for educational, informational, entertainment purposes only. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent attorney and please be advised. Today's date is February the 6th according to their calendar. For the record, I would like to reserve my rights according to the Bill of Rights and the Constitution of the Federal Republic. I'm going to continue on about contract law. So that day is going to come that these judges, these lawyers, this whole Illuministic system is going to be judged by the Supreme Judge. Some of you call him Yah. Some of you call him Yahweh. Some of you call him Yahweh. Some of you call him the Most High. Some of you call him God. Some of you call him by whatever name you may call him. Some of you may call him Allah, Elohim, the powers. This system, this Illuministic system, is going to be judged by him. And all of you Luciferians, all of you simple-minded, so-called complacent Negroes, all of you Shriners with your fezzes on, you Masons, you Elks, the Bilderbergs, the Rothschilds, the Majestic 12, all of you are going to be judged by the Supreme Judge. And they actually run this world. And this world is under Satan's authority. Barack Obama is under Satan's authority. You can't sit in the president's seat running the world and enforce the laws of the Most High, because we're taught that this world is under Satan's authority. This world is under Satan's authority. If the world wasn't under Satan's authority, Satan would not have been able to offer Yeshua, Yahusha, Christ, the entire rulership or the riches of the world. In order for him to offer that to Yeshua, to Yahusha, that means that this world had to be under Satan's authority. And you know, some of you know what I'm talking about, and others don't. But just let me touch on that very briefly, so you can understand what I'm saying, so you don't think I'm going off, or Tazadok is off of his rocker. The book of Luke, chapter 4, verse 1. And when Yeshua, being filled of the Holy Ghost, returned from the Jordan, and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Let's get down to the subject matter. Jump down to verse 5. Luke chapter 4, verse 5. And the devil, taking him up into a high mountain, showing him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. Now, when you read scriptures, brothers and sisters, you have to have the ability to interpret scriptures, because some of the verses are decisive, clear, to the point, but others are allegorical and they have hidden meanings. So you have to have that spirit to unravel the allegorical meaning to get the pure understanding. So what's going on here? Let's examine that statement. Luke chapter 4, verse 5. And the devil, taking him up into a high mountain, showed unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. So all the kingdoms of the world, Satan, the devil, showed to Yeshua all the kingdoms. Back from the time of the Romans, all the way up to now, inclusive of the United States, this corporation. All the kingdoms of the world, inclusive of the United States, the corporation that we are residing under now. All the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And what did he say? Verse 7. If thou therefore will worship me, all this shall be thine. So the devil told Christ, if you will worship me, all this shall be thine. And that's what many of you Masons do. Many of you go into it. And I'm going to hit you with something. The Masons is controlled by the Illuminati. The Illuminati controls all of this. And this started in 1776. You think 1776 was a declaration of independence? 1776 was the year that the Bavarian Illuminati infiltrated the United States and took control of Masonry here. Adam Weishaupt started this. They called themselves the Illuminated Ones. So all the kingdoms of the world was shown to Yeshua, and he said, if you worship me, all this will be thine. Verse 8, and Yeshua, Yehoshua, answered and said unto him, get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written that thou shalt worship the Lord thy power, and him only shall I serve. So he showed him all the kingdoms of the world. All the kingdoms of the world. Let's go to verse 6. Luke chapter 4, verse 6. No, we're going to start at verse 5 again. And the devil, taking him up into a high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, all this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me. And to whomsoever I will, I give it. I give it. I give it. What does that mean? That means in order for him to be able to offer Christ the glory and deliver all of this unto him, it means the world had to be under his authority. So you're operating under Satan's authority. So anyone that's sitting in the president's seat is operating under Satan's authority, because this world is controlled by Satan. This world is controlled by Satan. Now you could like it, understand it, believe it or not, but that's the truth. That's the truth. This world is controlled by Satan, brothers and sisters. You're operating under Satan's authority. That's why Yeshua said, the prince of this world cometh and have nothing in me. The prince of this world cometh and have nothing in me. Meaning it had nothing to do with him. This world had nothing to do with Yeshua. So now let's continue on. So let's get back to this contract thing. So these torts, these contracts, we have to actually closely examine. We have to closely examine these contracts before we enter into them. The questions of damages. We have to examine all of these things before we enter into these contracts, because many of you are going to get caught up. So brothers and sisters, back in the 1950s, statisticians in the Treasury Department and their long range 10, 20, 30 years of revenue budget and projection plots saw the combination of both inflation and percentage progression income tax would actually, in just a few decades, be pushing just the average worker into highly aggressive tax levels, up to 15%. Now, in the 1950s, those workers had actually been paying just a small percentage. It was actually known at that time that there would be public concern of the growing form of the growth from actually low taxation rates and to actually practical effect then. And then substantially higher tax rates would actually be expected in the future. And that public concern would actually grow increasingly with each passing year. And this is what has happened. And it was actually expected that the thrust of public concern that was actually out in the open would be the basics of the legitimacy of income tax itself. And this concern would actually have a strong current due to the percentage progressive nature that would actually accelerate into such a noticeable level when inflation was strong for several years in a row. So much so that even ordinary, blind, disinterested, naive, and political naive people would then perk up and take interest. And even businessmen would actually start to slow off rather than give away their hard-earned income. Now, with the annual increase in inflation, the public's questioning of actual the general illegitimacy of this income tax thing would actually be incremented with each passing year. So it would actually, it was actually expected that the public would notice that although greater taxes are being paid, no additional benefits services would actually be experienced or be in return by the king in 1 year to the next. So the illegitimate angles was actually expected to be the center of the gravity in the public's view. And since the general public is unaware of the ethical and moral basics of this excise income tax and of any actually attachments of equality jurisdiction involved, in other words, the king could demand and get anything from 0 to 100% in equality and be actually morally correct, because your participation with him in accepting his benefits and commercial equity is purely voluntary. And so any amount of gain you acquired in the king's commerce is gain that you would actually otherwise have. Now, This attachment of the king equity jurisdiction always precedes the liability for the tax. And so, it has actually been expected for some times that the United States, this corporation, would one day experience the most extreme and tolerable levels of income confiscation ever known to the American people without any reciprocity by the king. Call him president if you want to. Without any increased benefits to experience from one year to the next. And without any kind of justification at all, the annual percentage in tax extractions. This is a plot, brothers and sisters. So under the U.S. Treasury Department projection models and plots, it was predicted that open defiance would actually come someday, as such actually expected, these aggressive income tax levels. Now, they're simply not bearable by the average folks. And you voluntarily accepted this. Many of you voluntarily accepted this. Now, how did this thing go down? How much time do I have here? I'm going to have to continue in the next video. Shalom. Shalom, brothers and sisters. Once again, it's the voice of Brother Taz and Doc. Coming at you through the spirit of Yahweh Bashan. Once again, for the record, I would like to reserve my rights to the by the Bill of Rights and the Constitution of the Federal Republic. This is not legal advice. I did not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent attorney and please be advised. If you decide to use any of this information to fall on your face, it is your own fault because you did not research the information that was given. This is for educational, entertainment, and informational purposes only. I'm going to continue on with this contract law and how these schemes was actually pulled over on we, the people. This is part three. The first, it would actually discredit people like, for instance, Aaron Schiff and Armin Kondo, who actually propagated the legal defective tax related information around the countryside. These people was appearing on television and selling large numbers of books. These people developed a cult. They developed the cult and contributed to the institutionalization of public acceptance of defying the king. And their cult continues to grow, even though the information they propagated is misleading. And technically, it's defective and will collapse in front of a federal judge. But it's working. So tax revenues would actually decrease a bit in the near term as some people shift their status around to avoid being taxpayers. Tax revenues would actually increase a bit as the immoral and unethical positions of tax protesters is frowned on rather than cheered by these courtroom supporters. And the resentment against paying a high percentage of tax would increase. Now, the underground economy, so-called, would partially disappear as black markets and commodity can only exist to escape the forced intervention of government that actually creates unnatural pricing. The tax revenue would increase in the long run, as most of these folks who suddenly got rid of their bank accounts and other attachments of the king's equity to save money found out that the laws of income, benefits, cut off from commerce, and deprivation of mortgage and loans availability and other adverse secondary effects just wasn't worth it. And this is now happening on a small scale level. Some commercially oriented enterprising type patriots, so to speak, are now re-entering the highways of commerce and signing up with the king again, but this time under careful circumstances. They're careful how they contract, and these people refer to themselves as sovereigns, so over range. Now, near-term revenues would increase as taxpayers who now view the tax as either wrong, immoral, or illegitimate, then claim excessive deductions would be hesitant to do so. With the moral positions is actually shifted around, and now it's their failure to pay the full share that is serious acts of self-defilement on their part. Yeah, this is a big game. This is a big game, brothers and sisters. And it is the opinion of the staff members that although this is an interesting model to consider, its revenue generating strength from the king is in the correction of the wholesale public perception of the king being wrong and working immoral acts on the countryside. Now, since a majority of, I won't say Americans, of U.S. citizens, because that's what you become, still do not perceive things as being this way at the present time, this revenue enhancement and tax resistance termination model is best kept on the back shelves for a while. Now, what's the value in this story that I'm giving you? The value in the story, brothers and sisters, is the knowledge that the king, the president, whatever you want to call him, collectors in Washington are not the intellectual geniuses that you thought them to be. Not the dim-witted bureaucrats some people make them out to be. They're constantly polling public opinion and testing for factual knowledge to see what they can get away with. They are brilliant. And they know exactly what they are doing at all times. So, the Alphabet Group, the IRS, being one of them, knows exactly what it is doing, just like the king. And the 16th Amendment grounds is in place for just that reason. Because at present time, it is to the president or the king financial advantage to do so. Now, due to baneful public ignorance, should I say, and remember, the king propagates this enormous justification because the institutionalization of political perception of most Americans. So, I have a hunch that the king or the president is deceiving you all. And it's very unlikely that the king is going to would not switch public tax justification positions where it is actually to his own self-enrichment and financial advantage to do so. Now, just as there is a deception and lies in the conveyance justification being offered to, it's hard to say the American, so I say the U.S. citizens, for an unreasonably sized chunk of their wealth, month in and month out, year in and year out, without any let up in sight. So the income tax justified on the fraudulent terms by the these congressional men who, just like their king or their president, senior tax collectors today had a pure, perfect picture of the magnum torch of deception and lies. Brothers and sisters, if you were to believe congressmen trying to push the 1913 Income Tax Act through Congress, the world was simply crying out, insisting, and even strongly demanding that they be taxed. They looted. But if that statement from George Hull was not enough to turn your stomach, then perhaps some other previous statements from the floor of Congress in support of the Wilson Terrace Act of 1894, which actually contained an income tax rider, that income tax bill would not pass the Congress itself. Brothers and sisters, the King's policy ratio between the income tax bracket and the percentage of tax demand where it is because it lies just below the threshold of toleration. Many of you tolerate this, and it's not precise. So the king's agents are constantly surveying us folks out here in the countryside of this corporation known as the United States, to see how many of us are with tax brackets, so the king can actually reassess how much more tax confiscations can actually be extracted from us without an unimaginable revolt. I'm not inciting any kind of riot, but this is how this thing is going down. Brothers and sisters, we've been plotted upon. We've been schemed upon. We've been deceived. We've been lied to. Now, it was possible that the likelihood that the threshold of tolerance levels would actually be overpassed and broken. And that concerns certain senior bureaucrats down in Washington, D.C., who are wise to the practical secondary consequences such as passing of the threshold limit would actually create. So the meaning of this concern is perhaps best understood by the 1979 analogy of the oil pricing decision made by Saudi Arabia oil minister Sheikh Ibn Yamani. I don't want to go into too much of this, but I'm just trying to get you to understand this tax thing and how a lot of this madness went down. And a lot of you're trying to base things on good, moral, Christian values. You don't believe that these people down in Washington would do this to you. How can approximately 536 people in the District of Columbia manipulate and control over 350 million? Deception. Deceptive intelligence. Rationalized wrongdoing. You people better wake up. Brothers and sisters, you people better wake up. You better wake up, and you better wake up fast, because you're being deceived. These Illuminati's, this wicked Kabbalah has manipulated your thinking. Taxes, all other revenues, everything. Stop. You're all being deceived. we all are under the blanket of deception. And it's time that you unify yourself for positive measures to take. Divided, you're weak. United, you're strong. Now, you could just sit around and talking about how this thing is affecting you and not do a damn thing. Just sit around and get upset and get your picket signs and make a fool out of yourselves. It's time that the people wake up. They're depriving you. They want to deprive you of your guns now. They want to deprive you of the freedom of speech. Let them take away your guns and you'll be defenseless. You could best believe you're going to be deprived of everything else. Once again, my name is Brother Tyler Dopp. Shalom.